Hey everybody, welcome to T-Roy Cooks. Appreciate you joining us again. This is another Thursday edition, Thursday chat. I think this is episode 25, so cheers to me. Cheers to all of y'all too. Couldn't do this without your support, without your questions. If it's your first time here, if you've got a question, just leave it in the comments down below. If you're interested in any YouTubers I may mention or any products I may mention, just click show more down beneath the video and that'll open the description box, and I've got a lot of great information in there for you. Let's get to it. Cheers to you. Alright, let's see what we got. Now last week I left off with a question from John Diotto. He actually had two questions in his questions he asked, so I'm going to go with the second part. I answered the first question last week at the end of last Thursday's chat. So this week's question starts off again from John. He says, the wind chimes sound great. Could you comment on them? Thanks. Your Thursday chats are informative and I look forward to them, so keep up the good work. I appreciate that very much, John. Yeah, man, me and Karen, we took a trip out to Asheville, North Carolina. A city called Brevard, who has is famous for the white squirrels, albino. No, they're not albino. I mean, they've got brown eyes and whatnot, but they're white squirrels. Interesting story. Y'all check it out, Brevard, North Carolina. But in that same area, we were out chasing waterfalls. A good time out there. A lot of good waterfalls. But we found these chimes in downtown market area. And they're made by Grace Notes, gracenotes.com, if you're interested. They are tuned chimes, and they're guaranteed, I think, for 10 years. I mean, they're wonderful chimes. We love the sound of them. So you get that really nice sound because they're all tuned, okay? But yeah, good stuff, man. Gracenotes.com, y'all go check them out. I'll put a link down below. Ryan Talbot, what we got, Ryan? Hello, Troy. I had a question of what do you do for overnight cooks. Your Wagyu brisket you started at midnight. How did you manage your cooker? Did you just stay awake the entire time, or did you set up some temperature alarms and take quick naps? Ryan, I usually just stay up. I don't mind staying up, but like when I did that three brisket cook recently, where I had one in butcher paper, one naked, and one in tinfoil, I actually went to work that morning. So I got up at like 6 o'clock that morning, Friday morning. Got off work. When I came home, I started those briskets up around midnight that Friday night. By the time they were done, you know, Saturday evening when I had James and Tom Jones and, you know, Tom's Test Kitchen, all them over here, and Bessie from Bessie Dressie over here. Man, I was up at the end of that video. You can tell I ain't talking a whole lot. And I was up about 36 hours when we were cutting those briskets up at the end. So I got to thank Tom and James and Bessie and her husband for and Karen for that matter for helping me out. I was I was bad off. It's good stuff though, really good. But yeah, I just usually stay up. I'm not one to take little short naps. I'd rather stay up. What I have done, and I think I've mentioned this in a Thursday chat. Let's say I start to cook earlier, like I don't know, 5, 6 p.m. You know, when it gets around the stall, then at that point, I may take it off my offset and I'll put it on my Weber Smoky Mountain, which is already up to 225, ready to go. I may just transfer it over to my Weber Smoky Mountain and let it finish cooking on that. And that way I can go to bed and not worry about it, because my Weber Smoky Mountain will maintain that 225 throughout the rest of the night. But if I'm doing it on the offset, I'm staying up. Smoking Hams Country Cooking. That's Ashley, man. Y'all go check out Ashley. Smoking Hams Country Cooking. These have been really fun doing these Q&As. Here's a question for you. How much time do you spend on YouTube a day? Ooh, man, you'd be probably be surprised. Let me see. I bet I spend a good 6 to 8 hours a day. But a lot of that is answering comments, replying back with responses to those of you who have left me a kind word or a question. I spend also a lot of time on Facebook answering questions. People email me directly, you know, so I answer them as well. But most of my day, I mean, when I'm not actually working at my job, when I have some spare time, You know, I'll check and try to answer some questions or comments that way at work. But also, when I get home, from the time I get home until the time I go to bed, I'm on YouTube. Either, again, answering comments, checking out some of my friends' videos that they've put up recently, doing research if I need to on a recipe, just getting away from it all and checking out some other YouTube channels that I subscribe to. I do enjoy it, but you know, between the time I actually spend on YouTube, what I just mentioned, and then the editing and the processing of the videos, doing all the description box and tags and titles and all that good stuff, man, it's a lot of work, a lot of time. But you know, you get what you put into it, is my opinion. So, you know, if you just put an hour or two into it a day, that's fine. Nothing wrong with that. You know, if you really want to be successful at a channel, you've got to devote some time to it, which I'm fixing to be able to after May 12th. So, mentioned that last week. Let's see. Oh, he's got a second question here. What you got for me, Ashley? Who are some of the favorite channels that you watch? Have a blessed day, my friend. Good question. I'm subscribed to over 250 channels. And there's no way I can watch all of them every week. But there are some that I like to follow because they're young channels. You know, say less than maybe 2,000 subscribers. Less than 1,000, most of them. I actually jotted down some of them that I frequently watch, okay? And I'll put them down in the description box for you as well. I've got Ben's BQ, Danny's Cooking. I think it's Danny's Cooking and DIY, something like that, but Danny's, I've been watching him for years. Ellen's Homemade Delights. I don't mention Ellen enough, but she's a great friend. Elton's Barbecue Pit, that's my buddy from Norway, Jatil. Michael's Cereal. Michael's got a young channel, but he's doing pretty good with it. I think he's close to 2,000 subscribers now. But y'all go check him out, and I think Michael's the one that does everything, or pretty much everything, in cast iron. So if you like cast iron, check out Michael's Cereal. Patriot Barbecue, or Patriot BBQ, he's just an up-and-comer. Again, as most of these are, but there's some in there that have 2,000 subs. The Holler BBQ. Rivet Gardner, my buddy Rivet, man, he's always cooking at the Hacienda, him and his wife. And he's got some great dishes. A lot of times he'll do some like foreign style dishes too, which is cool. You know, so I like that little flair he has in there. Let's see. Also, my buddy up in Canada, his channel is called Green Bastard. Now, he does do some cussing and stuff, but the dude can cook. I like watching him. And my other buddy, this guy Walsh, he actually sent me a cheese board from Germany, man. He's over in Germany. The Punk Rock Kitchen. Y'all go check him out, man. He's got longer videos, but I love what he does. He shows how to make everything from scratch pretty much, man. I love that about his channel. And then I was mentioning a while ago that sometimes I just want to get away from the cooking stuff. I just want to relax and free my mind up of recipes and cooking and stuff. So I do watch a few gaming channels just to take my mind off everything. I watch Nick over at Trainer Tips. He's got a Pokemon Go channel. Get out of here. They got a bunch of yellow jackets they babies. They little bitty summer guns too. Trainer Tips. I like watching Ali A and his girlfriend Claire Chauvin, I think. Each of them have a channel. I like watching Lachlan over in Australia. Most of these are Pokemon Go or other PC games. Reversal. I watch Reversal. I think he's over in the Netherlands. Anyway, that's just a few of them. Let's see. Doug Dunlop. We're moving on. Doug says, love your stuff. Hey, I never hear you say much about cures. Do you use them and when? I don't really use cures, man. I just never have gotten into it. I know a lot of people do that. I just never have. You know, maybe if I do some more sausages and stuff, I may start getting into using some curing salts and whatnot. But I really don't have a need for them. I don't use them. You got any good recipes? Let me know. G-Man Cooks. I'm a G-Man. Where you at, bro? Cheers to you, Troy. Cheers to you, G-Man. What kind of editing software do you use in your videos? I'm looking to make my channel look more professional. I enjoy all your videos and congrats on 50,000. Yeah, I just crossed the 50,000 subscriber mark. So, again, thanks to all of you. Truly appreciate the support, man. I think I mentioned this before, too. Primarily, I use Premiere Pro. I use the cloud version, CC17, whatever it is, Creative Cloud. As a backup, I use CyberLink PowerDirector. So those are my primary two. In fact, that's my only two. But primarily Premiere Pro. And I've also got some add-ons to it. I think I mentioned Red Giant add-ons, you know, for the Premiere Pro. Good stuff. Anyway, GQ Barbecue. Cheers to you, T-Roy. What's your favorite beer to drink when smoking and grilling? Congrats on 20 and 50,000. Killing it. Yeah, I guess this was a question asked when I was just after I put up my 20th episode. So I'm at 25 now, I believe. Cheers to you. It's my good buddy Jason Ganahl in Denver. Got his own barbecue channel and his barbecue restaurant. Y'all go check him out. If you're in the Denver area, GQ Barbecue, or again, hit show more below to get to his channel, GQ Barbecue. What's your favorite beer to drink when smoking and grilling? If I just want to splurge, I'll get some Pacifico or some Dos Equis. You know, some of that's kind of, I'm like a lighter type beer. If I just want to hang out and I don't feel like spending a lot of money, a lot of times I'm drinking either some Bush beer or Lone Star. Isn't that what I got on here? Yeah, Lone Star. Good stuff. Every once in a while, I'll drink a Hams when I'm thinking about my good friend Keith Betag. Cheers to you, Jason, and cheers to you, Keith, along with all the rest of you out there, man. Appreciate it. Let's see, Terrence Dorsey. T-Roy, I wanted to get your opinion on smokers. I wanted to get an electric smoker or a pellet grill. What's your take on them? They're both pretty much set it and forget it. I will say you'll probably get better flavor and more temperature control out of the pellet. I know they're a little bit more pricey, but I've never had good luck with electric smokers. Even the little smaller, well, that's all I've ever actually seen was the little smaller ones, but I know they've got larger ones, which may be better, I don't know. Again, I think in that kind of situation, you probably get what you pay for. So get the best that you can afford. But if it were just me, I'd go with a pellet, if those were my choices. Munir Fernandez. Hi, Troy. Excellent video. This makes my day. Any tips on using the Weber Smoky Mountain with chips instead of chunks? I will appreciate any advice regarding this. Yeah, you're going to burn through the chips a lot faster. But you can get more condensed smoke flavor that way. If you want to, you know, wet down your chips and then kind of wring them out a little bit and shake off the excess water and then put them on your charcoal, that'll get like more intense smoke, but it's gonna burn quicker, so you'll have to add frequently, like once every hour and a half or hour or so, you know. And you could run the risk of over smoking the meat. I just prefer to use chunks myself, and I don't soak them in water or anything. But it's definitely doable. I used to do it before I learned about chunks. Let me see. Make sure I didn't skip one. No, I'm good to go. Adam Yeager, cheers on the 20th edition, 20th episode. It was a grilling. Appreciate everybody's support getting to 20, and now we're at 25. How about that? Have you ever done chili on a smoker? Yeah, man. I like putting my Dutch oven on the smoker and letting that chili get really nice. If not, you should try it. He says, I start the process on the stove and get everything together, and then I put it on the Weber Smoky Mountain with hickory wood and let it simmer at about 250 to 225 for a few hours. But it's some good eating. By the way, what type of beer do you drink in the Q&A segments? Cheers again. Adam, cheers to you, buddy. Let's see what I'm drinking today. As I've mentioned before, I like to change it up. I mean, sometimes it's just plain bush beer. But most of the time, I'm drinking a local Austin brew beer. And this one is Uncle Billy's Brewery. It's a Lazy Day Lager, if y'all can see that. And this is it's fairly hoppy. Almost too hoppy for me, but it's still pretty, it's a good drink. It says, share one with a sunny day. In Central Texas, there's nothing lazier than a float down a river. Lazy Day Lager features Vienna malts and noble hops for an incredible dry and drinkable brew. A golden libation that says slow down and savor the moments in every season. Lazy Boy. It's from Uncle Billy's Brewery. That's a guy floating down a river, in case you didn't know. We got a lot of rivers and creeks around Central Texas. So we go tubing a lot. Good times, man. But there you go. And I'll switch it out. When I finish this one, you know, next Thursday, I'll probably have a different company, or maybe the same company. If I like that one beer from that company I tried, I'll try some of the other versions of beers that they make. So I change it up. Supporting my local businesses. And I hope every one of you are doing the same. Appreciate the question, Adam. River Smokers. Hey, Troy Rich from River Smokers. Y'all go check him out. He's another newbie, but he's putting out some great videos, man. River Smokers. Let me see. At what point did you decide to put a PayPal account on for donations? And do people actually donate? Thanks from up here in West Virginia. Smoke on. Yeah, Rich, man. I had turned on that fan funding that YouTube used to have, but they killed that. And since I'm fixing to lose my job, you know, I'm going to go full-time YouTube. Any help would be appreciated. Again, I'm not going to beg for it, but there is a link down in my description when you hit show more where you can donate straight to my PayPal account. And, you know, if you don't want to, that's fine. If you have the option to do it and the gumption, and if I've helped you, help keep me coming to you. You know, I'd appreciate it. But it's just a one-time thing. You can go there anytime you want and click it. It'll take you to PayPal, enter your information, and it'll send me money. Works out pretty great. And yes, I have had quite a few people send me some money, which, again, thank each and every one of you that have. I truly do appreciate it. It helps me continue to buy the meat, the camera equipment, the lighting, the sound, editing software, you know, that like that Premiere Pro. I think if you just have Premiere Pro, you can get by with like 20, 25 bucks a month. But if you're buying everything like I am, where you get the audio and the Adobe After Effects and all that stuff, it's more like 55 bucks a month. So I got that. Plus, I got some other things that I pay monthly to help keep the channel as good as it is. You know, stuff to help me with my search engine optimization and stuff. You know, I use vidIQ. A lot of people use TubeBuddy, but I like vidIQ myself. So, and that's like 50 bucks a month or something. So, I've got my app, you know, for the Android and iTunes stores. That was like 800 bucks a year right there, and I paid it all up front. You know, so, I mean, there's a lot of expense to this. You can do it with just your regular cell phone camera if you want. But if you're going to want to make a business out of it, if you want to really have some decent videos and good quality audio, you've got to step up your game. You've got to have good equipment. And you've got to have great fans. So there you go. Any help, I'd appreciate it. But you're not going to hear me begging, okay? Let's see. Small Town Barbecue. Can you tell us the difference between natural prime corned beef? Yeah, man. Prime beef is the highest grade the USDA marks beef. And if I remember right, it's like the top 2% of all beef that is slaughtered and graded to sell. And prime beef is really, really marbled. You're going to find prime beef in most of your higher-end steakhouses. They're not going to serve you choice or select. Anything less than select is for dog food, basically, but or other, you know, animal feed. Then you got select, then you've got choice, and the top tier is prime. Mainly I use prime because I just like it. It's super tender, it stays juicy, and it tastes great, man. It tastes really good with all that marbling, all that fat marbling in the meat. Corned beef is, it's been through the corning process, which, and I may be misspeaking here, but I think it's almost like a, or it is maybe a pickling spice that you put the meat into, and it's usually a brisket that you corn to have corned beef. But you can basically corn the beef, and it I want to say marinating, but it's not marinating. What is it? It's like a brine, basically. Okay, it's like a wet brine with pickling spice. Think of that. And you leave it in there for, you know, a week or 14 days or 21 days, however long you want to leave it in there. And what you get out is corned beef. It's good stuff. But that's the difference. Michael Foster says, hi, Troy. What's your take on ugly drum smokers? I've been looking at the UDS a lot lately and the results look great. Will you be doing a build and a cook anytime soon? Keep up the great work, Chief. I recently got a pit barrel cooker, which is basically the same thing. And I have yet to cook on it, but I do plan on cooking on it, so I don't need to build my own. I mentioned Phil's channel before, Daddy Cooks. He's built his own, and he's got a fine-looking UDS. Let me tell you, he really put a lot into that, man. It looks great. It looks great, and it cooks fantastic, too. So if you got questions about how to build one or how to cook on them or anything like that, you might want to check out Daddy Cooks. Send him an email. And I get these questions a lot where I'm asked questions about cookers and smokers and stuff that I've never used, I've never owned. So when I give an answer on stuff like that, it's just from what I've seen and what I've heard and what I've read, because I have no personal experience on it. So you got to take that into consideration as well. So indulge me. I appreciate it. Alan Daly. Hi, Troy. I'm thinking about buying a Big Green Egg. Am I making a good decision? First barbecue. Well, after listening to my buddy Greg at Ballistic Barbecue, who joined me on episode 19 for these Thursday chats, he's got both the Primo Grill and the Big Green Egg. The Big Green Egg's been out there the longest, here in the U.S. anyway. So it's a very reputable company, and they support their product. But they haven't stepped up their game in the sense they haven't made upgrades to the Big Green Egg. It's basically still the same as when they first introduced it to the United States market. So they've fallen behind as far as the features of the Big Green Egg. They've fallen behind Kamado Joe. They've fallen behind the Primo. They've fallen behind the Blaze aluminum Kamado cookers. So there's a lot of options out there. Go with a reputable company. I mean, Big Green Egg's one, Kamado Joe, Primo. Those are three I would mention. I don't think you'd go wrong with it. I mean, it's basically a one cook everything type cooker where you can low and slow, bake, sear, cook pizzas high, you know, sear steaks and stuff. So you can do a lot of good stuff on it. If you just need one cooker, go for it. But I would also look at the Kamado Joe. I like the Kamado Joe myself because it's got the ash basket in the bottom. You can take out and empty your ash instead of having to vacuum from the top side all the ash out. So again, look at your options. Look at the warranties on them as well. Roshan Sims. Roshan's been around a long time. Cheers to you, my friend. Cheers to you. All right, Roshan's got two questions. Big T, we always talk about food. So if you were to go somewhere for a few days just to eat food and relax, where would you want to go? And then what would you want to eat? Thanks for all your time talking to us about food and how to cook it. Where would I want to go? You know, honestly, I miss Cajun food, man. I mean, I can cook it here, but I like going to Central and Southern Louisiana and just getting some fresh Cajun seafood, some gumbo, some etouffee, frog legs, fried fish, all that good stuff, man. Really do enjoy that. Plus, I got family there, so that I can visit family and have a good time. Plus, people in Louisiana, they like to party, man. Yep, good stuff. Big T, second question from Roshan. Forgot to ask, while talking to my grandfather, he was born in the 20s, 1920s that is, and he's still going. Well, congratulations for your grandfather, man. Sound like my grandmother. She was born in 1923. Mama Jean. Y'all may have heard of her. She's 90, 91, 92. Anyway, he was telling me about her, about some sour milk pancakes. Do you know anything about them, and have you ever made them? Maybe a video sometime of a sour milk recipe, the T-Roy Cooks way. Man, I have actually heard of sour milk pancakes, but I'm not a fan of buttermilk and stuff. I like buttermilk and biscuits, so I mean I can do that. I think sour milk is different than buttermilk, though. Maybe wrong. Anyway, I have not tried the sour milk pancakes. I could definitely try it because I know I can sour some milk. Get out of here. Get. He almost got me. You saw it, right? He almost got me. All right. Appreciate the questions, Roshan. John Doro, can you give us a tour of your backyard and barbecue pit area? A big fan. Watch all your videos. Yeah, John, I could do that for you. Let me shut off the camera and just turn it around. I'm actually going to start the video when I get back. I'm going to start it at my farm in my pool and work my way back where I am now. And my pits are over here to my left, to your right. So be right back with you. Hang on. All right, folks, hopefully y'all can hear me all right. Now, I was sitting right over there under my table under my back porch over there, and you can see little Fifi down there next to that cooler. And I've got my pool here. You see my nice pool. All right. I got all these palm trees over here. I got a nice big palm tree right up here. But there's where all my pits are. Let's go walk over that way. Let me show you what we got here. Here's a little closer. So here's where I sit and do my filming right here. I'm gonna go this way. Oh, look, I got me a new grill right here. This is a flip and flop grill, I think. It's got charcoal grill on the bottom down there. Put your chicken or burgers or sausages in there and flip that thing on. I'm testing it out. I actually bought it myself, but anyway, y'all be seeing that probably here in a little bit. I got my Weber Smoky Mountain, of course. Got my my offset there, my Wichita. Where you at, Wichita? Got my wood pile over here. And my Kamado Joe. These are those wind chimes you were asking about earlier. Y'all can see this. I don't know if y'all can see that or not. See, they're tuned wind chimes. Gracenotes.com is the website. Anywho, that's what we got, folks. Let me spin you around here. Well, I'm gonna show you my back porch here. A little area. See, I got all my grills set up here. And that's my little prep area right here. I usually cut up my stuff or put my rubs on my meat and stuff right there. And my pool's over this way. There you go. That's what we've got, folks. And over this way, that's where I sit. That's where I watch TV over here. That's my kegerator. I got my gas grill, my DCS gas grill over there. And we're getting ready to plant some growies over here. Karen just planted some herbs back over here in our raised beds. So, yeah, we got a lot going on, folks. I love that view right there. Let me show you what I'm looking at when I'm sitting in my chair over here. Hang on. This is my usual view here. See? Love this view. Just over here. There's my pits again. There's me. Anyhow, yep, this is what I got here, folks. Love our backyard. Appreciate you asking to see it. And the camera is, let me flip it around here. You can see where I sit. We'll get right back to where we were. Just like that. So again, thanks everyone for watching. I hope you enjoyed that little tour of my backyard area. We love my little backyard oasis. Me and Karen spend a lot of time out here. You may have seen my bathing suit and some beach towels hanging out. It's because we swim a lot. Yep, it's a nice pool. We do heat it up when it gets too cold. But yeah, man, we were swimming after we ate the briskets, when I had Bessie and Tom's Test Kitchen, and James was over here, we all went swimming after we ate that brisket. Had a good time. So anyway, thanks again, and thanks for the support, each and every one of you. I truly, truly do appreciate it. Much love to all of y'all. Y'all come back again next week. If you got questions, ask them in the comments down below. Don't forget to check out all the information I put in the description box. Just hit show more beneath the video, and I hope it helps. If y'all have anything else in there that you're needing, let me know. Anyway, we'll see y'all next week, folks. Hope y'all share this video. When you do, please tell all your friends that T-Roy cooks responsibly. Cheers.